tight end position is a problem. Whenever an offense steps on the field with a dominant tight end, the defense is always, always at a major disadvantage. At one moment it's George Kittle, Travis Kelce, or Gronk cosplaying as a sixth offensive lineman and bulldozing large humans in the run game. Then, on the very next play, they're running routes and tearing up defenders in coverage. The great ones can be used on the line, off the line, split out wide, or in the slot, and wherever you put them, they are a total mismatch in a game of matchups. They're too big for cornerbacks, they're too fast for safeties or linebackers, and if you have a good one, they are a problem. However, in the last few decades, NFL teams selecting in the first round have had tight end problems of their own. Strangely, all of the best tight ends today were drafted in the second round or later, and since Greg Olsen was selected in the first round back in 2007, none of the first rounders taken since have had standout careers, which is just one of the reasons why I'm worried about Florida Gators tight end Kyle Pitts. Pitts is one of the most impressive receiving prospects at the position that I have ever studied, and this year exploded with nearly 100 yards a game, 18 yards per catch, and 12 touchdowns. He is one of the most fluid, graceful route runners in this year's class, despite being 6'6", 245, and has a bigger catch radius than anybody in years. But at the same time, his receiving ability does not at all match his blocking ability, where he regularly misses blocks and often gets bullied off the ball. He's naturally a wide receiver, but since he's bigger than even a Calvin Johnson, he plays tight end. If you spend a top 10 pick on Pitts and he wastes time at tight end, a position that historically takes players longer to develop, when he really should have been playing receiver all along, it could limit his development and possibly ruin his career. On the other hand, tight ends are more valuable than receivers, and if Pitts can become a better blocker while destroying teams as a receiving threat, well, this is why we have a problem. There's no doubt he's at his most dangerous when he's flexed out away from the ball, which he was 36% of the time in 2020, and that's where he did a lot of his damage. Florida mainly utilized him as a deep threat, which is not at all typical for a tight end. He was targeted on average nearly 14 yards down the field, which was fourth in the country. Really, most of his catches came in that 10 to 15 yard range up the left sideline, and 25% of his receptions went for 20 or more yards. The reason he consistently wins deep is because of the diverse set of techniques he can use to beat you. He wins with speed by stretching the field and splitting brackets. He'll beat you with counter moves at the line or down the field to disengage nearby defenders. He'll go up to make catches in traffic with reckless abandon. His catch radius projects to already be one of the largest in the NFL, no joke. And his release package is surprisingly multiple and varied to the point where you'd never know he's a tight end. While you'd typically expect that position to win with brute force and power and punish guys off the ball, Pitts loves, almost to a fault, to slow play his releases and take his time to set up his prey, then attack. One of his favorites is called a diamond release, where the receiver sells outside, usually for three steps, although Pitts doesn't always abide by the three, then drives back inside off their instep to cross the defender's face. Your three hard steps out sell a vertical type route. Then once the defender opens his hips outside, you break back in. Pitts sees the cornerback Warren Burrell is leveraged inside to try and take away the slant, so he knows he needs to generate space so he can get back inside. Good receivers create uncertainty in the defender and make him guess where they're going to force them out of their technique. Pitts knows if he can get Burrell to overcommit outside, he can create space for the slant, so he varies the tempo in his diamond release, waits until Burrell flips his hips and commits outside, then shows hip flexibility and lower half bend that you never see from a 240-pounder. The natural feel he has for the receiver position pops up time and time again on film, and his ability to vary the nuances in each release to truly build a release package is special. Watch how he gives Burrell a similar look to the diamond with the same tempo, and even starts outside to make it look like he's going back in like he just did. Burrell's a little more cautious of that slant, so he doesn't know what's coming, and at this point, he's completely guessing. When Pitts sticks inside, Burrell shoots his hands and stops his feet to defend the slant, but Pitts in stride quickly uses a swim move and beats him up the sideline. You can tell from watching him, he really almost has like a sixth sense as a receiver. And like I mentioned before, where he doesn't necessarily use his power off the ball, he's very comfortable using counter moves to keep defenders off of him. When you're using slower releases like he does, the last thing you want is to get press coverage since it can completely disrupt your timing. But if you beat it, it can turn into a big play. Pitt starts with what was going to be some sort of slow hesitation release, then is surprised by Bryce Thompson immediately sticking him in the pads, but Pitts doesn't panic. He attacks the elbow, which is one of the weak spots for the DB, chops down with his other arm, and would have been wide open if Thompson didn't hold him after getting his butt kicked. Pitts is very comfortable beating press, which you can't say about many tight ends or receivers in college. Really facing any type of man coverage is where he's most comfortable, since every linebacker, safety, or corner has trouble staying with him. He averaged 4.91 yards per route run versus man, which was the third highest in the country and nearly 2 yards more than any other tight end. Pure one-on-one man is just not going to get it done against Pitts, so defenses have to deploy extra resources to guard him, which often doesn't matter anyway. Ole Miss is showing a too high man coverage pre-snap, but takes this deep safety out of the middle of the field, effectively doubling Pitts, which also allows their corner Jay Stanley to press him at the line. Since he's running a fade, Pitts uses a hop release to hold Stanley in place so he can explode past him outside. Just like before, Pitts isn't thrown off by the sudden press and reacts naturally. Even though Stanley gets right into his pads, he uses perfect technique to attack his elbow, swim over that arm, trapping Stanley inside, and brings his leg all the way through to clear Stanley's outside hip. He accelerates to restack Stanley so he can maintain room up the sideline for the throw, all while feeling the safety who's coming over the top. He shows off his catch radius, his hand-eye coordination, and his ability to track the ball and adjust. Pitts constantly creates big plays in tight areas, which is one of his most impressive qualities. Even when he has no room to work, if you give him an inch of space, he's gonna do something crazy. Florida actually misused him a lot of the time by lining him up almost on the sideline in plus splits way outside, but yet he still routinely made insane plays on the ball, even when he was kinda set up to fail. Defenders will have him completely blanketed, but he's still somehow always open, which makes man coverage near impossible. It's easier for defenders when they can use the sideline to their advantage to squeeze the receiver out of real estate, but not when you're going up against a dude like this. When Pitts is flexed out as a receiver, he's terrifying to try and guard, but when he's bumped inside or in line as a more typical tight end with his hand in the dirt, that's where I start to see problems. There are just too many times where he struggles getting off the ball when a lineman bumps him or a linebacker gets their hands on him, and his route running becomes way less effective. His quicker speed-type releases are pretty good when he's lined up outside, but when he doesn't have time to use his slower releases, like he does when he's flexed out, and can only use speed on the inside, he's just not nearly as efficient. This play against South Carolina is kinda Pitts the inline tight end in a nutshell. He's a little slow off the ball against the lineman since he inside releases. Then since he's not in space, he can't react to the linebacker the same way, so he can't get to his counter moves or really create much separation. But then when the ball's in the air, he goes and extends for a crazy catch, even though he couldn't get that foot in bounds. He's just not as dominant a player when he's lined up inside, and he's not a very good blocker at all. He'll miss man blocks, he'll miss zone blocks, he has trouble generating movement on D linemen and double teams. He'll attack defenders on the wrong side of their shoulder pads, so he's actually blocking the defender into the running back as opposed to kicking him out from the gap. And he's not very good in pass protection since he struggles to maintain his pad leverage and proper weight distribution. Yes, there are certainly some good blocking reps, so I'm not trying to make him out to be flat out atrocious, but that area of his game certainly needs a ton of work and makes me question his viability as an inline tight end at the next level. History most definitely gives us reason to worry. There are so many examples this past decade or so of teams spending high-end first-round draft capital on tight ends who don't reach their potential. The position historically takes longer to develop, since they not only have to learn the tight end position, but also the wide receiver route tree, pass protection, the run scheme, how to account for blitzes, etc., etc. A team has to ask themselves where they're gonna play Pitts, and if they might be stunting his growth by playing him at tight end when he might truly be a wide receiver all along. And then, how much does his value change if he is a wide receiver, since a dominant tight end is more valuable than a dominant receiver? And does that change his opportunity cost when the 2020 receiver class is way deep with guys like Devontae Smith, Jalen Waddle, and Ja'Marr Chase? There are of course elements of Pitts' game that can be improved at the next level, so he's not a finished product by any means, and he's just 20 years old. I'd love to see a team utilize his speed and playmaking ability as more of a yards after the catch threat a la a George Kittle, but Florida just didn't really use him like that and didn't unlock that aspect of his game. There's more meat on the bone for Kyle Pitts, which is a scary thing to think about. He has ludicrously high potential, and when you think of all the types of ways he can make an offense better and the different manners in which he can attack the defense, it's tantalizing to grab him with that top 10 pick. Do you move him to receiver and let him expand on his most impressive qualities? Or do you keep him at tight end and hope he develops into a multifaceted monster? It's the biggest question whoever drafts him will have to answer. But what you can't question is this man's crazy talent. Any way you slice it, Kyle Pitts is a problem.